Thank you very much. I came to know that I'm on the program just a few days ago, and it said that I'm supposed to speak about South Asia. I'm not an expert on South Asia, and I've been doing a lot of comparative work on many countries, including in India. So I thought I will, and we've had a lot of discussion in a way in the last 2 days at the micro level, at the state level, at the national level. I wanted to present a picture of what does India look like compared to other countries. This research, actually the idea for this research came about because there are a number of economists working on agriculture in India that have been saying that India's structural transformation has slowed down. And it's partly because India's agriculture is not doing as well as it could. So because there were a number of these papers, I decided to do a comparative study to see how India compares in its structural transformation with other countries. And this was work that was done jointly for a meeting organized by the Indira Gandhi Institute, the Planning Commission, the World Bank, FAO, all the usual suspects. So I'm just very quickly going to present findings which are, you know, which are in a fairly large paper, but in 20 minutes, forgive me if I go very rapidly in this. I think the definition of what does structural transformation mean is fairly clear for economists. It is basically a reduction in the role of agriculture in the economies as they modernize. And so there are five different characteristics of what structural transformation means. So what we were asking was, how does, and you know, most economists say that agricultural productivity growth is absolutely fundamental for structural transformation, because when people move from the rural to the urban sector, demand for food increases, and unless the agricultural sector becomes more productive and is able to produce more food with limited number of limited population in the rural sector, you will have terms of trade changes which will make food much more expensive, and it will arrest the rate of transformation. So what role has TFP, the total factor productivity in agriculture, has played, and what explains the differences among countries. So this explains the methodology. I won't spend any time on it. My primary interest, although we were looking at 109 countries over a 30-year period from 1980 to 2009 to look at transformation, my primary interest was in the four large countries: Brazil, China, India, and Indonesia. All those countries that I happen to be have worked in, but also they have very different set of problems than small countries. So I wanted to see how they are dealing with those issues, how they are performing, and especially with BRICS becoming more important, this comparative interest has increased. So the role of agriculture in economic development over time, what seems to have happened is that China and Brazil's agriculture is contributing much more to their overall economic growth than is the case with India. Indonesia was not doing that well in the earlier period, and its performance has improved. When you look at the hunger statistics, and FAO has recently revised its numbers, then again you see that the number of people hungry in China has greatly declined. In South Asia it has declined. India's numbers have declined a little, but it's not a very impressive performance. Then if you look at South Asia, again India dominates. Bangladesh's numbers reported at least have diminished. Pakistan's numbers have increased. But anyway, India's performance in terms of feeding the hungry is generally lackluster, and a huge concentration of the poor in the world, poor and hungry in the world, are now in South Asia, including in India. So agriculture's role is very important for transformation. And what we were looking at is how do countries perform. There are the general rules that the share of agriculture in employment declines, the share of agriculture in GDP declines, the share of value added in agriculture increases, and share of per capita value added in agriculture increases, because as agriculture becomes more productive and fewer people are left in the agricultural sector, then agriculture is per capita, on a per capita basis, is adding a lot of value. So we considered the 109 developed and developing countries and 88 developing countries. And you can see that in many respects their performance seems quite similar. For instance, value added in agriculture increases, etc. What we found very interesting was that how you can tell the reduction in poverty in agriculture is when the percentage of population in agriculture and the percentage of GDP in agriculture begin to coincide. So that agriculture, whereas at early stages of development, there are large number of people in the agricultural sector, but the percentage of contribution of agriculture to GDP is diminished. So this the figure on the left, in a way, the figure on the, is it on the left or the right from you, where you are looking at, the one that rises, that shows you that basically countries are moving in the right direction. And if you look at all 109 countries, you get an impression that yes, everybody is reducing the percentage of population in agriculture as their GDP declines in agriculture, etc. But if you look at only developing countries, then you find that this pattern begins to break down. And they are flat almost on their back. There is no reduction in this diminution of poverty in agriculture. So why is that the case? So we disaggregated this data. And then we found that by and large, Asian countries are again moving in the right direction. By and large, Latin American countries are moving in the right direction, but Africa is not moving in the right direction because its agricultural productivity is not doing as well as it is doing in Asia and Latin America. So now I'm going to break this down a little further by only looking at China, India, Indonesia and Brazil. What we were doing here is to look at where are these countries in terms of the trajectory of transformation, and you can see India is the green one, a little behind Indonesia, and China is way ahead because its productivity has increased, as you will see in the later parts of the presentation. Brazil, by the way, is completely in a different sphere, but it's been losing a lot of labor from agriculture, so its productivity is growing rapidly. But it's also losing a lot of labor in agriculture, which is not the case in Asia, because our land-labor ratios are completely different than they are in Latin America. So that is one of the additional issues that we were looking at. How much employment does agriculture create when it increases its productivity and efficiency? Now, another thing that was very interesting was that intersectoral terms of trade, which is prices between agriculture and non-agriculture, have been declining rapidly in most parts of the world except in Asia. And you will see that as the, in 2007-2008, the world food crisis began, Asian prices began to rise a little bit. And in that sense, China, India and Indonesia move very closely together. They show the same pattern, which is quite different than in Latin America, and I'll come to that in a minute. Now these are the terms of trade for South Asia, and there are differences among South Asian countries. If there was more trade, more regional integration, we would not see as much difference in the terms of trade as we do here. Now I'm going to move to the question of skipping a number of other issues and moving to the question of total factor productivity growth in agriculture. And generally, ag economists have been saying that total factor productivity has been, the rate of growth has been diminishing over time since the Green Revolution. And you can see this is based on per hectare yield. So they're only looking looking at land productivity, not total factor productivity. But there seems to be a scientific consensus that yield growth is slowing down, and that's a matter that should be of concern to all of us that are concerned about how agriculture contributes. People who have been looking at total factor productivity in agriculture are seeing that those countries that have invested a lot in what they call the technology capital, they have done much better in their total factor productivity growth than countries that haven't invested enough in technology capital. So these, the high bars that you see are China, Brazil, the two countries that have done very well in investing in their technology capital, compared to India, for instance. And that then shows up in the rate of growth of total factor productivity. The red line is for China, the yellow one is for Brazil, the black is for Indonesia, and the green is for India. So you can see India is kind of falling behind in total factor productivity growth according to these estimates. And if you look at South Asia alone, then India doesn't look that bad. But I think because there are a number of other countries that are not doing as well. So then we then began to look at countries in more detail. And what struck me, we did massive amount of review of literature for China. There are large number of studies in China on what is happening to total factor productivity. I mentioned that because I think there's been a lot of discussion that we are not doing enough empirical research. And I'm struck by the extent of empirical research going on by professionals in China on a variety of issues related to agriculture. So, you know, studies were coming out of my ears and I had to select a few. So this is one of them, and it shows the pink parts show where productivity is growing particularly rapidly. And you can see that these rates of growth in certain provinces in China are extraordinarily high by, you know, world standards. And this is what is happening to productivity growth in Brazil. This green part, Mato Grosso, is very close to the Amazon, where productivity is growing very, very rapidly, and it's also leading, among other things, to deforestation, which is something that I happen to be working on at the moment, to see how productivity growth is creating incentives for deforestation, which is contributing to climate change, etc. These are the numbers. We found very few studies on total factor productivity growth in India, and that to me is an indication of the fact that the degree of scholarship and networking by Indian ag economists in doing this work is not as great as it is in China or Brazil, both internally and collaboratively. And you know, these numbers change. If there are a couple of good years, then productivity doesn't look as bad as it does when. So I want to qualify this. They come from India, and we found that where production is growing rapidly is not necessarily where productivity is growing. So one has to really make a distinction between production growth and productivity growth, and especially total factor productivity growth. So then, in order to break this problem down further, we started looking at area and yields. And that is a question that came up when the presentation was made by Mr. Gao yesterday about China. You can see that China's area under cereals is the red one. It has been slightly declining, whereas India's has more or less remained steady. But look at the yield growth in China on cereal yield growth, total cereals, all cereals. And similarly for Indonesia compared to India. If you look at irrigation, India was behind, as I was saying a couple of days ago. Then China is caught up with China, and obviously it's all related to groundwater growth. If we look at what's happened to expenditures, public investments in agriculture in India, you can see that the share of total investments, public sector investments, agriculture has been, its share has been declining, and no wonder that Indian agriculture has not been doing as well as it should. So that is obviously something which needs more attention. This is where, as I mentioned the other day, we looked at World Bank projects and where it had lent to water and irrigation. And this is the performance of India, the green one with the arrow, etc. And this is the performance of other countries. And as you can see, China has done, in terms of World Bank ratings, much better. The question that these evaluations ask are fairly simple. What were the objectives of the project and the extent to which they were realized? And then the evaluators then rate the projects by their performance. And you can see that India's performance has not been that great. Now, they began to break down the problem in why is it that Chinese agriculture is doing so well and Brazilian agriculture is doing so well. And you find that there has been huge investment in the rural sector in a variety of ways in China. We've looked at only Brazil, parts of Brazil that are growing, there are parts of Brazil that are not doing that well. One is energy, and actually the total energy use in China is much larger than all of Southeast Asia and South Asia, which is phenomenal. But if you look at the energy use with respect to per capita income, which is the way people look at energy efficiency, then there has been a huge increase in energy efficiency in China. So their income is increasing, but the amount of energy unit they are using is much less than is the case. And this is the pattern, by the way, for all of Southeast Asia and East Asia. India's energy efficiency is also increasing, but not to the same extent. Now, these are the numbers on investment in agricultural research. We are organizing a meeting in February here in India. We're getting the Chinese and Brazilians and Americans and everybody to talk about what the Chinese are doing on agricultural research and Brazilians are doing, which Indians are not doing. And you can see that the green one on top is the rate of growth of investment in agricultural research in China. Together, if you add up the investment by Brazil and India, China's is greater than number of scientists, amount of publications, number of patents. You measure it by any criteria, and they are doing very well. So no wonder that their agriculture is doing well. Then look at transport, and I have many, many majors of this, but I'm just going to present one or two. They've invested a lot more in transport. India was ahead in the 1960s, but China has caught up and exceeded India. They're trading more, by the way. Although their productivity has increased a lot, they've diversified their agriculture a lot more than we have. We are much more stuck into rice and wheat production than is the case in China. But they're also trading, so they're importing a lot more than India is. And then I end this by showing that if you look at India compared to other countries on social assistance expenditures, a share of GDP, you can see this figure. India is quite high on social expenditures compared to other countries, but not as high on productive investments. And I think if there is one single message that I like to leave from this analysis, comparing India with other big countries, is that they are investing a lot more in transportation, in power, in educating their people, in their scientific capacity, in a variety of ways, in a way that we are not doing. And that's part of the reason why we have much higher incidence of poverty, much slower rates of growth in agriculture, etc. Thank you very much.